Well, church, this is our final week in John's first epistle, and I don't know, you know, if you're going to cheer for that, or mixed feelings, or, oh, Sam, can we just do it back to back again? And I said, yes! You know, but we have gone through verse by verse, and my hope is, and my prayer has been throughout this, that the Holy Spirit has illuminated the truths of God's word to you as we have embraced this letter in its entirety. And I've said a few times that it doesn't mean we're done and dusty, like, yep, check that off. The spiritual checklist, 1 John, never to return. But, you know, this, I mean, we've just scratched the surface, really. And we don't view this systematic approach of going through the book as the only way that one could preach and teach scripture, nor have we adopted this legalistic approach that says we could not possibly divert from one week to another topic or tarry somewhere else. But what a shame it would be for us as believers if we were to get to the end of our lives having found that we've really only just savoured a few choice morsels of meat, you know, our choice passages, choice scriptures, choice books of the Bible, and we've neglected the rest of this tomahawk steak that is the full counsel of God's word. So that is what we are attempting to tackle and to digest. And I think I said at the start of this book, or maybe I said it sometime last year, you know, as an example, many of you are familiar with John MacArthur. I think he took 7 years to preach through one of the Gospels, Matthew or something like that. So I think 6 months for 1 John was reasonable. Who knows, the next book might take me 7 years as well. Starting July, with all that said, you will be starting in a new book. You will find out about that in the coming week or so. But let's eagerly look forward to what the Holy Spirit will do within us, increasing our love of the Father and our sanctification. So, for the last time this year, I don't know, please turn with me to 1 John 5. We're going to be reading the final few verses, from verse 18 to 21. 1 John 5, 18 to 21. And if you are able to this morning, and your body permits, please stand with me as we read his word. What a privilege. Think about throughout history what the followers of Jesus would have given to have, you know, scriptures within their hands. And now we have, you know, multiple copies at home, and we can access it in a moment on our phones. And some of you have it propping open doors and stuff like that. But we want to treat it with the awe, the respect, the reverence it deserves. So 1 John 5, 18 to 21. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. I've entitled this morning's sermon, church, Three Things to Know. Please bow your heads with me as I pray for us this morning. Father, once again, we acknowledge that apart from you, Father God, we can do nothing. Apart from the Holy Spirit illuminating Scripture to us, Father God, it is just merely a mental exercise, and we want it to be more than a mental exercise this morning. We want your Spirit to illuminate the words that we read and the words that we hear, and so that we would grasp the truth of your word, and that it would transform us more and more into the likeness of your Son. And we humbly ask that you would do what only you can do in our life once again this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please take your seat. Firstly, verse 18 starts with, we know that everyone who's been born of God does not keep on sinning. We know. It is evident. It is an unquestionable fact and a known reality. And that box, what are we talking about? Everyone, all men and women, boys and girls who have been born of God. Right, this is what it's referring to. Do not keep sinning. But let's pause there for a moment. I want to look at what does it mean for us to be born of God. You can ascertain this answer, church, throughout Scripture, in numerous places. But the Apostle John tells us what it means in 1 John 5, verse 1. Go back in this chapter. He says, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, or has been born of God. Everyone who believes, pistuo is the Greek word, believes and entrusts their life to God, due to God inbirthing faith within them. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Promised One, God the Son, has been born of God. And we sing that bridge of that well-known song, and I love it. You know, we sing, the cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back. And you know, believing in Jesus, church, we know it is more than just an intellectual belief, an acknowledgement or an admittance. But instead, it is a belief that allows us to declare and to walk out the truths that we read in Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and who gave himself for me. And church, I would ask of myself, and I would ask of any other man or woman, boy or girl, who would tell me that they believe that Jesus is the Christ and therefore have been born of him, I would say to them, what have you forsaken in entrusting your life into the hands of the King? Because the reality is, the one who truly believes into Jesus the Christ, the one who is truly being born of God, will evidence, one, a change of desire and affections, two, a forsaking to pursue the King and his kingdom and his righteousness, and three, a daily abiding, as the vine daily abides in the as the branch daily abides within the vine itself. And so much of 1 John lays out in no uncertain terms the evidences and therefore the assurances of salvation. Scripture, as well as the testimony of the Spirit within us, leaves us with no uncertainty regarding whether or not we are born of God or if we're not born of God. It's great, and that's a comfort. And I don't think any believer should ever remain in a place where they're asking themselves each day, oh, am I saved? And we've talked about this quite a lot this year. Right? The Scripture doesn't indicate that. The witness of the Holy Spirit does not indicate that. And the reality is, this is why the fact that salvation is solely and wholly dependent on God's grace is enough and should be enough to make us cry and get emotional at each reflection. Because if it was up to man to play a part in his salvation, we would, amongst many things, always question whether our part or our work in salvation was enough. And therefore, whether we are truly legitimate children born of God. I think I'm saved. I think I've done what I needed to do. I think I somehow believed enough. I think I've somehow done enough. But because it's dependent on us in our minds, in some way, we'll always have that question. But when it is not up to us, right, when it is a work of God, we can know that we are truly legitimate children born of God. Because God is the author and finisher of our salvation, we can have this great assurance, church. An assurance that spurs us on towards greater love of the King, while simultaneously freeing us from the bondage of this meritorious, works-based, God plus me, God plus my efforts, salvation. I'm sorry if you ever taught something else, but there is nothing for you and I, nothing for us to earn this morning. It is a free gift given by a gracious and merciful Father, of which every disciple of Jesus here is a recipient of today. And that is a great thing. That is a great comfort to me. Verse 18, we know that everyone who's been born of God, so all of the disciples of Jesus this morning, I'm talking about you and I. So what's next? We know that everyone who's been born of God does not keep on sinning. And John is repeating to us what he proclaimed to us in 1 John 3:6. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. And we know this abiding isn't talking about, you know, this once a week church attendance, or whether or not you are adhering to, you know, a devotional fairly regularly, or, you know, even living and behaving like the world, but somehow just acknowledging him with your lips, with your hearts far from him, like the Pharisees in Matthew 15:8. We know that's not what's been talking about. In fact, that word abide, it talks about this continual remaining, right? And even more so, the meaning that we actually derive is the same word that they would use to talk about weaving, to weave something together. And we are woven together, church, to Christ by the Spirit we have received from him. So therefore, no one who has believed into Christ Jesus, no one who has entrusted their life to him, no one who has been woven to Christ by the Holy Spirit, no one who has passed from death to life by the sovereign grace of God continues to sin. A true disciple of Jesus will not, true disciple of Jesus cannot continue in a habitual pattern of sin, nor have a habitual attitude towards sin. And I've said this a lot, and I feel like we don't need to clarify this, but I will clarify this. I'm not, you know, you would have known from all the other sermons in 1 John, I'm not talking about some sort of sinless perfection and saying, oh, as a disciple of Jesus, you should never sin once you came into a saving faith. That's not what I'm talking about. It is this continuing in a habitual pattern of sin and having this habitual attitude towards sin. Because the reality is, yes, we acknowledge that our sanctification is a process. Right? We acknowledge that we still daily contend with the flesh. Yes, we acknowledge that the mortification, the subjugation of sin, is an active endeavor for the believer, not a passive one. For as Galatians 5:24 tells us, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Yes, we acknowledge that despite the Holy Spirit's empowerment, we still often fall short and take our eyes off of the greatest treasure and surpassing word of Christ. But the one who is born of God will not live a life that is given over to habitual patterns of sin. I just wonder, you know, I've got a good idea. You know, we're in a culture that, a culture of tolerance, and really that does boil down to, you know, accept what I say, and if you don't agree with what I say, you're not tolerant. And that has crept its way, I think, into the church, for sure. And, you know, somehow as disciples of Jesus, we feel as though, even though we read sayings in Scripture, that, you know, we don't have the right, nor should we, maybe, you know, call others to that standard. Not in a legalistic way, but say, hey, if you claim that you're a disciple of Jesus, you can't be living in habitual sin. It doesn't make sense. But we're so quite often worried about ourselves and the discomfort for ourselves that we remain silent. And we allow people to continue believing that they're saints, believing that they are right with God, but not demonstrating any fruit of salvation. And I think of John Newton, right, the former slave trader turned abolitionist and Anglican clergyman. You know, he was for those of you not familiar, he was the author of that hymn, Amazing Grace. And it was him who said this on his deathbed, and I think many of us, myself included, we can identify with this. He said, I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I want to be. I am not what I hope to be in another world. But still, I am not what I once used to be. And by the grace of God, I am what I am. Read it again. I'm not what I ought to be. We want to look like Christ in this lifetime, church, but we know we still, even with the Holy Spirit sanctification, we are far off from that. Even though we're moving towards it. And I'm not where I want to be. Every believer should have that desire. Not for this aesthetic reason, you know, that somehow people in the world would look and they'll go, man, he's so good. Look how good he is. Right? But no, because we want to be more like Christ. We want to be set apart, holy as he is holy. And so John says, I'm not what I want to be. And I'm not what I hope to be in another world. And we know that one day we will be glorified. And the presence of sin from our lives will be gone forever. He says, but still I am not what I once used to be. And isn't that a reality that we have all experienced this morning, church? We are not what we once used to be. And I'm not talking about just purely behavioral modification. I'm talking about the fact that the Holy Spirit now dwells within us. Our lives have been transformed and changed. And yes, we are not perfect. And yes, we still fall short. But there is a difference. We have been taken from darkness into light, from death to life. And the evidence is now in how we walk and how we talk and who our eyes are fixed upon. And John Newton finishes and says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. God's grace is sufficient for the believer, church. It is his grace, the Holy Spirit's empowerment, that allows us to walk out of life when we are no longer slaves to sin, but slaves to righteousness, as we read in Romans 6:18. Not only does the one born of God not continue in a habitual pattern of sin, but they also don't have this habitual attitude towards sin. And I asked this question last week, church. What is our attitude towards sin? Do we hate sin? Do we seek to put it to death wherever we find it? Do we forsake it? Do we flee from it? Are we grieved by it? Or do we somehow view sin as innocuous? Or do we view sin as a limiter within our lives? Something that we can, or we believe that can happily coexist in a heart that is also indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Do we secretly relish sin? Do we embrace it? Do we befriend the very thing that placed our Savior on that cross, that he died for? And in Romans 6:1-2, Paul writes this, he says, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Those verses deserve a sermon on their own. But to expound, just because we have been justified, made legally right by the death of Jesus Christ, and have been saved by grace through faith, the free gift of great cost, does this mean that we should maintain a casual relationship with sin, indulging whenever we feel the temptation with the thought that somehow God's grace gives us a license to habitually sin? And Paul says, by no means. That actually translates better to may it never be. May it never be. The one born of God is not out looking to, like a young child, I know that as a man, you know, test the boundaries. How much sin can I commit and still get away with it and still be able to turn up to church on Sunday without somehow feeling too conflicted or having other people notice? It's not the attitude of the one who is born of God. Rather, as they are sanctified and as they grow in their love for God and their love for others, they also grow deeply in their hatred for sin. They see it for what it is. And this is the hallmark of one born of God. They seek to be holy as he is holy. And as I said, not for aesthetic reasons, not to garner the praise of man through this outward appearance of piety, because the Spirit of God has opened their eyes to the beauty of the gospel. the words of eternal life, and because they have an understanding that an abundant life is only found in Christ. And so verse 18 continues, it says, we know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who is born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. What's it saying there? He who is begotten of God, born of God, speaking of Christ Jesus our Lord, protects the one who is born of God, and the evil one, Satan, does not touch him. And I read this and I think it's an incredible promise to us as believers. The evil one does not touch us, or more specifically, we read the evil one does not take or lay hold of us, does not grab a hold of us and keep hold of us. And in this, I think we should take great hope in the following two things. One, the evil one, the enemy, Satan, cannot take away our salvation. And Romans chapter 8 is so theologically rich, and we can spend a year in that and around it, and still only scratch the surface of that. But let me draw your attention to something that's very familiar to you, Romans 8, 38 to 39. It's a very commonly quoted passage. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Right? Let's not just chew this verse out this morning because we are familiar with it, right? Or just relegate it to, you know, Scripture's top 10 motivational quotes and it makes the hit list on the back of the toilet door. Has anyone got Scripture on the back of their toilet door? Anyone want to own to that? A few of you. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that at all. But as with everything, there can be a danger, right, where we become inoculated to something. And so let us not view this passage in the same way. Because do we truly meditate on what Paul is really communicating here? There is not a single thing that can separate us from the love of God. And this is more than God being like, yeah, I love you, Sam. You know? Or us relating to it any sort of continued love of another person. Like this, like, you know, Manny tells me all the time, like, you know, it's lovely, I'll never stop loving you. And wow, that's amazing, right, to hear someone else say that. But let us realize that this cannot even come close to being in that same category as Romans 8. This love of God is more than just a continuing warm affection, but rather it manifests itself according to 1 John 4, 9-10. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not only that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. And church, this is the love of God towards you and I this morning. Salvation through Christ Jesus, which nothing in this universe can ever separate you from. The evil one cannot lay a hold of you and rob you of your justification, your sonship, or your eternal inheritance. As Ephesians 1:13 tells us, when we heard the word of truth, when you and I heard the word of truth, the gospel of our salvation, and believed in him, we were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. We know that every believer is indwelt by the Holy Spirit, and we have therefore been sealed by him. This union, this indwelling, attests to and signifies whose we are. We are the Father's, and those who are his forever. Nothing the enemy can do can change this, church. John 10:28, Jesus speaks of the elect and he says, I give them eternal life and they will never perish. And no one will snatch them out of my hand. Man, that is a great hope for us this morning. Secondly, I think it's important to realize from this verse in John, the evil one cannot operate beyond what God in his sovereignty allows. John 17, 14 to 15. Jesus, again. He says, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. The reality is that although Christ's death on the cross has sealed Satan's fate, we know that he is still hard at work here on this earth, church. I mean, 1 Peter 5:8 tells us that the enemy, the evil one, he prowls around like a roaring lion. Right? Not just prowling around, but he is seeking someone to devour. We must have a correct theological understanding of not only sin, but also of the enemy, the evil one. And he isn't just this comical red devil with a pitchfork, right, that we somehow not take seriously, nor is he the antithesis of Jesus, the, you know, opposite but equal in power and knowledge and dominion. Have you seen that? I think I made a joke of this because I put up that picture of Jesus and Satan arm wrestling and they're like locked in. Do you remember that? Oh, it was only this year, was it? Yeah, I put up a picture and it's them there, they're locked and they're going for it. And that is a false representation of the reality. A false comparison there. The evil one is no match for our Lord and Saviour. 1 John 3:8 tells us the reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. And our victory against sin and death, I remind us again this morning, church, it is assured. And in the end, the evil one will be cast into the lake of fire. But whilst we walk upon this earth, he is still active, right? Seeking to shake the faith of believers and delay and disrupt their sanctification, to distract them with the pleasures and the systems of this world, and to keep them from the good works that have been planned for them. Luke 22:31-32, the Last Supper, Jesus says this. He says, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers." And Satan sought to sift Simon Peter like wheat. Has anyone sifted, everyone knows what sifting is, right? People still bake here. A few bakers, you know what I'm talking about, right? He sought to shake him, to cause him to falter and to fall. But what's interesting is when we read this passage, it says, "Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat." The "you's" are actually plural there. It wasn't just Simon, Simon Peter, that Satan was coming to shake. It was actually all of the disciples. And obviously, you know the story. That was the reality. I want us to take comfort in this morning. Whatever the evil one comes at you to shake you with, he cannot take your salvation from you. He's restrained by the sovereign will of God. There is nothing that occurs that is outside of God's knowledge or control. And your trials, your persecution, your suffering do not have to be without purpose. Rather, allow them to bring about greater sanctification. Remain in him so that you may walk well, and so that God may receive all the glory due to his name. And we know that, and yet to walk that out is another thing entirely. But we are called to walk that out. The evil one or any evil spirit cannot lay a hold of you to have their way with you like they can in the lives of the unbeliever. Because we are born of him, we are his, and his spirit dwells within us. What a comfort. It's comfort to me this morning. Verse 19, our second thing to know. Secondly, we know that we are from God and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. I have appealed to you from Scripture regarding what it means to be born of God. And so has the Apostle John throughout this epistle. Right? So what is he restating and re-emphasizing here? Because we talk about the spiral. And we're just going on this spiral. Look, you can look at it as a spiral up, maybe. Downward spiral always seems negative. But we're hitting these same points. So what is he re-emphasizing? And I believe, again, that he's trying to draw our attention to the distinction between believers and unbelievers. And I think, because I look at my own life and experience, I really believe that there is a danger that we can somehow, in our minds, view mankind in three categories, right? We have believers, disciples of Jesus who have been saved by grace through faith. We have good non-believers, right? Those people who have a sense of morality. You know, they're generally nice people. They just don't confess a faith in Christ Jesus. And then we have the bad non-believers, right? Those who are the chief transgressors, the real slaves to sin under the power of the evil one. Everyone's got at least one of them in their family, or no. You know, the real bad ones. The people you hear about on the news. But the problem here is this is not what Scripture teaches. 1 John 3:10. By this it is evident who are children of God and who are children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. Those who practice righteousness are born of God and are his children. Those who do not are children of the devil. Let's throw something at me this morning. This is what Scripture tells us. Romans 6, 16 to 18. Let me read this to us. Verse 16. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? Either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. And having been set free from sin, have become slaves to righteousness. Slaves of righteousness. Every man is a slave, every man is a servant to something. And Scripture teaches that every single one of us were born into this world as slaves to sin. Born sinners with a proclivity, not neutral, with a proclivity towards sin as our inherent state. But the believer who has received the free gift of salvation, having been set free from the penalty and the power of sin, is now no longer a slave to sin, but a slave to righteousness. There are only two states to be in church: dead in our trespasses or alive in Christ. There are only two positions of the heart, church: active rebellion against a holy and a loving God, or total surrender to a holy and a loving God. There are only two masters that you can serve this morning, and everyone is serving the master. It's either God or it's the evil one and his worldly system. There are only two ways to live, church: in and of the world, or in the world but not of the world. And it is a great deception of the enemy that would have us view things in any other way. The church, our nice, friendly, unbelieving family members and friends, right, because we all have them, are just as much rebels, slaves to sin, and staring down separation and damnation and eternity separated from a loving God, right, as the thieves and the adulterers and the murderers and everyone else that we would view as the bad non-believers and the chief of sinners. And people, now it's not a popular message, but that is the reality. And a while back, a number of years ago, I was incredibly convicted by the Holy Spirit about this. How crazy that I would ever have, these friends in my life, family members who are non-believers, and I've never shared the gospel with them. And I was happy enough to just say, well, you know, preach the gospel, or when necessary, use words, but conveniently, it seems to never be necessary to use words. How crazy. If I've been born of God, if I've been set free, and no longer a slave to sin, but a slave to righteousness, my life has been transformed. How can I not say something? If I love them, how can I not say something? And just in case there would be anyone who would misunderstand me this morning, say, oh, Sam's calling everyone sinners. Say everyone who is not a Christian, you know, they're rebels and they're slaves to sin, and, you know, like he's so good. Ephesians 2. Let me read this. This has to be my favorite, I reckon, probably my favorite chapter in Scripture. Having said that, there's a lot. But because I read this and I think, oh man, this is it. This is the reality of my life. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked. Yeah, I was. You were. Following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work, presently at work, in the sons of disobedience. While everyone who is not in Christ, among whom we all once lived, in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. That was our state. And it's not like we came to Christ and somehow we forgot about our former life. You know the reality of a life that was apart from Him. Every disciple of Christ here today was once following the evil one, the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. And the sons of disobedience are every single person who are not born of God. And this is who we were. Slaves to sin, dead in our trespasses. And verse 4 continues. It says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. The whole world, the people in its system, church, scripture tells us it lies in the power of the evil one. People enslaved to sin. We've been brought out of darkness into light. We've been saved, we've been justified, and are being sanctified. We've been set apart. We have been called to be holy as He is holy. But we're also called to preach the gospel, to make disciples. We're called to take the good news of Jesus to the lost and call those enslaved to sin to repent and believe the gospel. The Apostle John, he makes a distinction to show us that the fathership, the fatherhood of those born of God and those who are slaves to sin. But he doesn't just give that distinction to us so that, you know, somehow we can sequester ourselves away. We've been born of God. We've been born of God, and we're just going to keep to ourselves until we go home to be with Him or He returns. That is not the case. Rather, it should spur us on. Our love for the Father, a reality of what our lives were like being slaves to sin, but now slaves to righteousness. It should spur us on in our evangelism, born out of a love for God and the lost. And there, church, there is no middle ground for the unbeliever. Either you're a slave to sin or you're a slave to righteousness. Either a son of God or a son of the evil one under His control. And how awful if our unbelieving friends never receive the gospel from us. How awful if you and I were just content to relegate them to, you know, well, yeah, they're one of the good ones. Oh, they're just such a good person. And I would question that according to Scripture when we talk about people and say, you know, I don't know what we mean, but what does it mean to be good? God is our objective moral standard. He is goodness, right? But what if we just relegate them to that? Oh, they're lovely and they're good, and you know, they just don't believe. And how awful if I make an idol of my feelings and my comfort and avoid telling those that I claim to love the reality of their separation from a God who has made a way for them to be reconciled to Him. And let us never forget, as we read stuff like Ephesians 2, the reality for the redeemed, but also let us never forget the reality for those who are lost. Thirdly, finally, we know from verse 20 of our text, we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know Him who is true. And we're in Him who is true, in His Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. And we can say, church, that this verse is the rightful summation of this first epistle. And for those of you who could think back 6 months ago, right, when we began this journey, we talked about how the Apostle John, with this letter that he was writing, he was seeking to affirm the nature of Christ. His humanity, but also His deity. And in doing that, he was trying to combat this thing called Docetism, this series of beliefs, and it was one of the early forms of Gnosticism that was becoming pervasive at the time. And that, if you remember from from our first sermon, you know, docetism, it comes from that Greek word, I think docet, meaning to appear. And it was this belief that was being spread that, you know, Jesus did not have a real physical body because there was no way that, you know, the Son of God could possibly entangle him in human affairs, but rather he just was here as an apparition. He just appeared to be real. And so it's fitting that right at the end of this letter, in parting, John wants to restate, I guess, the linchpin point. And that verse, that word know that we read in verse 20 is ginkonosko, right? Or a couple of variations of that, but same root word, which speaks of a knowledge that has come not just from being told, but a knowledge that comes from experience. And so John is conveying here, and allow me to elaborate, this elaboration is mine, exactly what he has come to know through experience. He says, we know that the Son of God, right, has come, and he has come to this earth, fully God and fully man. He has walked among us and lived a perfect life and taught us about the Father. He has demonstrated who he is, who he claimed to be through his words and his deeds and his signs. He was crucified, he died, and he rose again on the third day. He appeared to me and to a multitude of witnesses, and then he ascended into heaven. That's what John knew. That's what so many of the apostles, those in the early church knew. Not only this, but he has given us an understanding. And when we read that word understanding, it means one side to the other side, a full breadth of understanding. And I think about 2 Corinthians 2, 3 to 4, and the Apostle Paul saying, and even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. But this is no longer our reality. By the work of Christ on the cross, by the drawing of our hearts by the Father, by the work of the Spirit to regenerate our dead hearts, we are able to have a full breadth of understanding so that we can know him who is true, the Father, and are in him who is true, his Son, Jesus Christ. When John says that we can know him who is true, every time you read that word true there in the Greek, it implies more than something that is just factually true. It means something that is genuine, right? In direct opposition to something that is fake or fictitious or counterfeit or simulated. He is the true God, the genuine and authentic God and eternal life. And in him we have eternal life, church. John 17:3, and this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And the Son of God has come to this earth, he came to this earth to give us an understanding, and so that there could be a way for us to be reconciled to God. Only through him is this possible. He is the true God, and he is eternal life. And we know that there's not just a future hope for us, but it is a present reality. And so in the very final words of this first epistle, John leaves us with this. He said, little children. Remember, that was a term of endearment. But also, he was older, writing, so many people would have been younger. So, little children, he said, keep yourselves from idols. I think if you were to take this single verse on its own, it would make sense in one sense, but then not in others, right? Well, the apostle finished with this, right? There's no nice farewell, no other kind of summation. He just said, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Pen drop. See, John here isn't referring to statue of Baal, or Moloch, or a graven image of any other little g god. Rather, in the context of not just the preceding verses, but the entire epistle, it makes complete sense. John is saying, be on guard against counterfeit gods. Be on guard against something that is not genuine. Be on guard against the misrepresentation of Christ and his gospel. John is saying with all fatherly concern, little children, be on guard against those who would deny his deity, deny his humanity, deny his work upon the cross, deny that those who are born of God will walk in the light, walk with the light. And he writes this. Why? Because there were many people then, and there are still many people today, who create and peddle to others, idols, gods of their own creation, appealing, shiny, but impotent, with no power to save. And so the Apostle John in our text, he gives us three things to know. But there is a fourth surprise. I'm almost done. May we know the God of Scripture. That's the fourth. May we know the God of Scripture and the Son who he sent. Church, the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. We were all rebels, all of us. I know you, just in case you're looking at me and you're like, oh, Sam's such a perfect example, and if it wasn't for his hair, he'd be even more perfect. Man, you know, I'd never get up here and I promise you, I'd never preach a sermon without God having, you know, convicted and dealt with me in the area before, you know, because I'm not. And like you and I, we were all rebels. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are rightly deserving of his just and righteous wrath, hell and eternal separation from him. Yet, in his immeasurable love and mercy, God sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, fully God and fully man, to live the sinless life that we could not live and to die the death that you and I deserved. God treated Jesus on the cross as if he lived our life so he could treat us as if we lived his life. On the cross, Jesus bore our sins, satisfying the wrath of God. He rose from the dead, conquering sin and death. And his death and resurrection afforded to us not just our justification, wham, bam, and you're done, you're made legally right, but eternal life. This is the good news. This is the gospel. This is why we turn up here every Sunday and then we go out and we are daily abiding in him. Because our lives have been transformed by the good news. Christ died for sinners, reconciling us to God. And now Christ calls us to follow him. And I would call us this morning. I would call each and every one of us, everyone this is applicable to repent, turn away from your sins, and call upon the name of Jesus. There is only forgiveness through him. Only abundant and eternal life through him. Only one way to the Father, and that is through him. Repent and believe this morning, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Do not delay. Tomorrow is promised to no one. Call upon the name of the Lord this morning and be saved. Please stand with me this morning. I am aware, I'm preaching to the choir. Let me pray. Father, it's been a privilege just to work through your word together. And thank you for the truths revealed to us by your Spirit in this first epistle of John. But Father, let it have not just been merely an intellectual exercise, but allow your Holy Spirit to illuminate the truth that we have heard, that we have read, that we have meditated on, Father God, and allow it to transform us. And thank you that you offer us an assurance of salvation to believers, that we never have to wonder whether or not we're going to somehow maybe make it in the end, like it was up to us, or still for us to merit. But you have given us an assurance through your Spirit, the testimony of your Spirit within us, and through what you have laid out in your word. And Father, thank you that for every man, woman, boy, and girl here this morning, that you've made provision for them to be saved. Thank you, Father, that you call everyone to follow you, to repent, to forsake their sin, to call upon you, to place their trust, their faith in you this morning, Father God. And I pray for anyone whose heart may be gripped this morning, whose heart may be drawn, that they would surrender to you, Father God. Surrender their lives to you. Lord, our aim is not behavioral modification, but life transformation, and that is only done through the power of your Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
We remember that this morning. Thank you for the good news. Thank you that we can rejoice in that good news.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Christ came to save sinners, of whom many of us were the chief. And thank you that you made a way whilst we were dead in our trespasses. And by nature, children of wrath, following the evil one and his ways, slaves to sin, Father God, thank you that you were rich in mercy. You sent your Son to die for us so we could have new life, Father God. And as long as we have breath within our lungs, let us proclaim that and hold to that, Father God. Let us be faithful in taking that and sharing that, Father God, because the gospel, the good news, has power for salvation for all who would believe this morning. We thank you, Lord God. Continue to sanctify us, Father God. Continue to draw our family and our friends who don't believe towards you. Let us be faithful, Father God, in taking this gospel to them. Lord, let them know, too, where they're going to go, what's going to happen when they one day pass from this life into the next. Not just a vain hope, not just an incorrect idea about the afterlife or any other place, Father God, but may they come into a saving knowledge of you so they can rest in the assurance that abundant life, eternal life has been afforded to them both now and forever into eternity. And if you've not been told this morning, or you've had reason to, you believe doubt, I want to tell you this morning, church, that God loves you so much enough to send his only Son to suffer and die in your place, take the punishment that you deserved. And that same Jesus calls you this morning, come, follow me. Pick up your cross and follow me. Father God, let us follow hard after your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you, church. Please hang around. Have some